Sales. I need to stand here because I didn't bring the pointer where I can press. Okay, these are some of the topics over here we're going to cover. Alright. CISG again. CISG as a revision to all of you, Convention on Contracts for the International Sales of Goods. CISG. So CISG is a very important regulation in the international trade with regards to sales of goods. So the CISG adopted in 1980, example, 1980, incorporates rules for all the major legal system. So it talks about rules and regulation, rules and regulation with regards to sale of goods in international trade. And this CISG is born out of a convention in 1980. So it provides accepted substantive rules on which contracting parties, the salesperson and the buyer, the court and arbitrators may rely. So it has been ratified by 72 countries. So if you look at the chapter in the book, I think the second page of the chapter, it lists those countries are observing the CISG. What page is that? Okay. And some countries, I think this was the latest edition, so we're not too sure. This was as of 2008. I think they already be a member by now. Transactions covered in CISG. CISG applies to contracts for international sale of goods. The buyer and seller must have their place of business in the different states. Okay. So both of the states must be contracting parties to the convention. As I highlighted in the red font, both members, the buyer and the seller, must be the member state of CISG. We have a case talk about it to explain about this. Both of the state must be contracting parties to the convention. That means they are part of the member of the convention that explains the CISG. The rules of private international law must lead to the application of the law of a contracting state. That means we can use some of the domestic law. I have also another case to explain about it. A ratifying state may declare that it will apply CISG only when the buyer and seller are both from contracting state. Opting in and out. So this is very simple principle. I think you have learned this in the previous class. Whether you want to use CISG or your own state law, you can always opt in or to opt out. Parties to a contract may exclude or modify CISG application by choice of law clause. Remember, you learn about this choice of law. A choice of law clause is a contractual provision that identifies the law to be applied in the event of dispute. So you also have a choice of law. In the case of dispute. So normally it will be mentioned as a clause in the contract. Every business there is a contract involved between two parties. So we can put always whether you want to follow CISG or you want to follow the state between either clause in the contract, choice of law, whether choose CISG convention or you want to use the law of state. It can be the buyer state or the seller. You can choose always. Asante Technologies Incorporated versus PMC Sierra Incorporated. Okay, the issue is, if you read the case, does the US Federal Court have jurisdiction and does CISG apply to this contract? I always remind you in the class, you don't have to remember the content of the case. You just go to the issue, the principle, and what was the verdict. That's all. Always remember this. What was the issue? What is the principle? And what is the verdict? Normally, the verdict will be using the principle to explain. So the issue over here is, does the US Federal Court have jurisdiction and does CISG apply to this contract? And this comes from the two states, British Columbia and the California. The court determined the parties were from different states, British Columbia and the California. And CISG applies to contracts between such parties, because US is part of CISG. The parties did not opt out of the CISG and it was the controlling law, because they did not mention in the clause that they wanted to use other than CISG. So it is a binding, a controlling law. That explains that you always have opportunity to opt into CISG or opt out from CISG by choosing the law that you want based on the buyer or the seller state. Sales defined. Okay, this is some definition about sale. We just use the normal layman term over here. Look at the last sentence over there. Define sale as the passing of title from the seller to the buyer for a price. That means you exchange goods. You exchange goods for a price. Goods for a price. So when you exchange goods, normally, it's a very literally explained over there. Exchange of goods for a price, that means you change title from the seller to buyer. Earlier, this is the owner, now this is the owner. So change of title of the ownership of the goods. Goods are defined in a bit different way and they have excluded some parts over here. Let's look at it. What is the general definition of goods and what they have excluded? A good is a movable, tangible object. Yes. All of us know that. Movable means something you can move. That means you can transport it, you can export the product, you can see the product. For the purposes of the CISG, goods do not include things bought for personal use. That means you buy something for yourself. It always should be a economic gain or a transaction for a economic gain, a profit. For personal use, no. Or at an auction or for closure sale. So whatever that you buy for auction, all this not been included. Nor may the ocean going vessels or aircraft. So we do not include all those things. So it's good now for you to remember the definition in a very clear way, so that when you explain about a certain issue, you define it before you begin to explain about the issues. So over here, mixed sales, seller of goods often furnishes services when delivering a product. For example, like CISG looks upon mixed sales and service contracts as sales of goods, unless the normally when you sell something, it also includes some services such as transporting the goods to your house, to the business premises, where it involves some service, because you need to transport the product from one location to another location, from one business premises of seller to another business premises of a buyer. So there are some element of sales. So we also include those in the definition. So some of the contractual issues that CSG excludes are as follows. CSG only deals with the number 1 and 2, and what do they exclude? 1, 2, 3 and 4. So let's look at what they deal with. CSG only deals with the formation of the contract. That means the contract formation, what are the clauses should be in, what law do you choose, choice of law, okay, and what the price, okay. So these are the things that CSG covers, the formation of the contract, and the remedies available to the buyer and seller. So later we look at some of the remedies. If one of them did not honor the contract, what are the remedies? What are the remedies to buyer and seller? What are the remedies to buyer and seller when one of them did not honor the contract? So CSG also covers that. I will go through with you in a short while. Did not honor the contract. What does it mean by did not honor the contract? Did not follow. As I promised to you, I will do a reset exam, so I need to honor what is my promise. And sometimes it's very hard, you know, to honor whatever we say in our life. Same goes to business. Sometimes we say one thing, but we don't do that. So whenever that thing happens, remedies will kick in. So remedies means how much compensation you have to pay, how many X for the price, what are the losses that you have to bear. It will be the remedies. And what CSG excludes? CSG excludes questions about the legality of the contract, the competency of the parties. That means we don't go and mess around whether they are capable or not to sell the product. It's not CSG's job. The rights and of the third parties. Because once the legality of the contract means we have all the clauses, yes. But whether the contract is enforceable, of course you have to register the contract. There has to be registered with the legal office, where they have to be pay some stamp duty and whatever to make the contract legal. The rights of the third parties and the liability for death or personal injury. So CSG do not talk about all this. Preemption. If CSG applies to a particular contractual issue, domestic law, as I mentioned to you earlier of the slide, domestic law can be used, is preempted. Remedies provided in the CSG are the only remedies available. So preemption helps to fulfill the goal of the convention to establish a uniform rules for international sales and contract. So there is a case to explain about this, how the domestic law comes in. Sometimes, so sometimes in the contract of sales, we also have to obey the rule of that particular country in the member state. If drug is not drug, drugs, let's say between member state A and B, if drug is drug is the violation of the domestic law. So this becomes a preemptive precedence, comes first, that you cannot go and do a business based on where the goods are drugs. Maybe country A can. Which country in the world where we can deal drugs? Netherlands. So that's a country that we should visit, lah. How the people live there? Netherlands. So in this case, so they should not go into the contract because the domestic law becomes preemptive. If not, we just open the floodgate. Everything we can do. So therefore, we have this as a preemption to protect the. To interpret CSG, a court is to consider the international character of the convention, the need, of course, the CSG itself, the need to promote uniformity in the convention application. As you can see, all the convention, is the purpose is this, so that we have uniformity in the dealing. For example, you learn about services, you learn about sales of goods, labor, remember those chapters we learned. All the convention want us to be promoting uniformity, transparency, and all the parties should do business in a good faith, open, transparent, do not hide facts, share. So these are the things that, you know, CSG also observe, the observance of good faith as well. Okay. This is how we should interpret CSG. CSG is not a burden to the seller and buyer. CSG is something that help the buyer and seller to do business in a very harmonious way in the world, respecting the individual state law and where the preemptive comes in. At the same time, we also want a uniformity of application of the convention to all the member states. And of course, and the third one is good faith. That's important. Interpreting CSG, again, general principle. What are the general principles over here? Two of the suggested principles are: a party to a contract, let's look at number one over there, a party to a contract has the duty to communicate information needed by the other party. If whatever information the other party needs, please provide. We cannot. So this is where the disclosure comes in. Disclosure. Disclosure comes in. You do not conceal it. Do not conceal. Do not conceal information. Please disclose it. Like myself, I disclose all my midterm marking to you, isn't it? One thing I have not disclosed to you, the scheme of marks. Have you seen scheme of marks for final exam? I have not seen yet. You should know. How the scheme of marks for marking for a paper that you are sitting in? But sometimes it's very confidential, we do not share. But you always can walk into my room and ask how it's been marked, you know. 1 point, how many marks? One example, how many marks, for example. So, when come to an international trade, the two parties must always disclose. Do not conceal facts. Parties have the obligation to mitigate damages resulting from a breach. Over here. Remedies. So whenever someone did not honor the contract, so we have mitigation plan, how to pay compensation based on the remedies that we have agreed upon when we do the contract. Interpreting sales contracts. A contract is said to be formed only when the parties have a meeting of the minds. Okay, that one is just explanation. This subjective intent approach says that contracts should be interpreted according to the actual intent. So whenever two parties meet to do a transaction, what was the intention? To make profit or to sell something. So you must always look into the original intent. Original intent is what? To sell something. Intent. Not to cheat. Not to cheat. So this intention is very important. Intent. If the original intent is to cheat someone, it's not in a good faith. So the intention should be, the subjective intent approach should be in a good faith. So I am trying to mention here. The objective intent is the pricing, for example, is objective intent. This objective intent. Subjective intent is the whether it's a good faith or not a good faith. Good or the bad faith. This is important, intention. Can you know a person's intention when they do in contract? Can you know whether they are in good faith or bad faith? Do you know? Can you know? Do you know? Maybe not. Can you know or not? Can. If you do business for a long time, I think you are able to learn the body language. Body language is very important, and you learn in other subjects of the business where you have to do some homework, look into the background of the businessman, you have to look into the past success record. So these are the information that you have to look at before you go into the sales contract. Because sometimes objective intent you can look at it by, like, for example, price and so on. How long the duration to sell the product or the goods, all this can be known. But the subjective intent is sometimes quite difficult. Quite difficult, huh? Of course, we have remedies, but you know, you go into the mess of the issues. And you may also encounter loss. Negotiations. When a court is determined intent, CISG directs that due consideration be given to all relevant circumstances, including the negotiation leading up to the contract, the practices that the parties have established between themselves, and the parties' conduct after they agree to the contract. Right? Practices and usages. Parties are bound by any practices which they have established between themselves. Okay? For example, like, you want to have 30 days practices, practices, which can be in the clauses as well, where they mention that 30 days credit, for example. It's one of the practices. Due care. For example, you want to buy roses from one country overseas, they take due care of the product when they ship to you. So these are the practices of that particular seller. So parties are bound by any practices which they have established between themselves, where they have mentioned it in a contract. A court is allowed to consider any usages that the parties agree to. A usage is the customary method of performing or acting that is followed by a particular group of people, such as people with a particular trait. Let's look at it. What is that? CSG lets a court consider usage of which the parties knew or ought to have known, which in international trade is widely known to and regularly observed. There is one case here that I want to, over here. That explains about the cost of dealings of customer usage in trade. Okay, this case 10-2, you can look at your textbook. Tribeca Industry AG versus Allegheny Technologies Incorporated. The defendant, TDY, entered into a consignment contract with the Tribeca, then refused shipment. Please underline the word there, refused shipment, when he found a cheaper supplier. Okay? So that means they did not honor the contract. They refused shipment when it found a cheaper supplier. So court had to interpret under the CSG the word consignment. What is this? You should turn on whether that word should be interpreted according to the meaning based on the cost of dealings or customer usage in trade. So the court applied cost of dealings and awarded these damages to the party. That means It is a law. It has been captured in the CSG. And in the consignment, it is normally people have to honor the contract. They cannot always go back and say cannot, because they say it is not a practice in our country. No. So they have to honor it, and they pay the damages to the party. So these forms are the contracts. We are talking about the hard copies of the contract now, how the form should be look like. So must be in writing, as I highlighted over there, must be in writing. So a contract is formed when an offer to buy or sell a good is accepted. An offer is a proposal by one person to another to indicate that they want to involve in the transaction of goods, to change the title. To be a valid offer, the offer must communicate intention to be bound. So the offer must be communicated, must be in good faith, alright. Effectiveness of an offer, so all these are the some of the conditions that we want to mention. For example, an offer becomes effective only after it reaches the offeree, a specific person address in offer, all these some of the principles that you can look at. A firm offer is an offer that the offerer promises to keep open or fix a fixed price over a fixed period of a time. So these are some of the conditions that we have to look at. Offers also can be withdrawn before they reach the offeree. So even though offer has been communicated, but we also can withdraw. Acceptance. A contract comes in existence at the time the offer is accepted. Then also highlighted over there on the fourth bullet, acceptance must be received within the time period specified in the period in the offer. If no time period is given, then it's okay. But if it's a time given, then you have to accept it before the time ends. So there is a due date as well. Offer, there is a due. Okay, there's one case here, United Technology International Incorporated versus Magyar Legi Kozlek Desi Valad. Okay, so plaintiff offered to sell aircraft engines to defendant at a specified price in a quantity to be selected by the defendant, depending upon how many planes they purchase. So defendants send acceptance. Term requiring government approval was not a condition as a precedent. So an enforceable contract was formed because they have sent the acceptance. So sometimes you find difficult to remember the case over there, the title. You always can say that in a case that involves selling of airplane between two countries where the government acceptance is not a precedence, where the other party already accepted the offer and becomes an enforceable contract. So you always can mention that way. Rather than you don't write anything about a case. You got it, Anna? So over here we talk about the withdrawal and the rejection, as I mentioned to you earlier, withdrawal and the rejection. Again, these are some of the principles that you would have learned in the business law. If the offerer asks for performance of an act rather than the indication of acceptance, the acceptance is effective when the act is performed. So if the other person asks you to do something, but instead of saying accept, but you have performed the act, it also means acceptance. An offeree may withdraw his acceptance before it been accepted. Of course, the rejection also can be done when it reaches the offerer. If the acceptance modifies some of the terms of the offer, there is a counter offer instead of the acceptance. So if the offer has been communicated but there is some new condition being offered, we call it counter offer. So the original one does not apply anymore. We call it counter offer. Counter offer. K-4 Philanto SPA versus Chili Beach International Corporation. US old map, you know, USSR, huh? Now there's no USSR. So Chili Beach was supplying boots to a Russian company that were being made by Philanto. It's a boots, huh? So Chili Beach made reference to an arbitration clause in the Russian contract with Chili Beach. So we talk about the domestic law here. So Philanto failed to object to the incorporation by reference to the Russian contract in a timely fashion. So the arbitration clause becomes part of the contract requiring arbitration in Moscow. So we call this choice of law and also the preemptive. So when you explain about the preemptive, the domestic law, you always can say that in a case between a Russian company where it involves the selling of boots, and what was the principle applied and what was the arbitration verdict, where what was the choice of law they have used. Fundamental breach: when one party breaches, the other party may avoid the contract or make a demand for specific performance. So there comes the remedies, where the other person, one of them did not honor the contract, breach of contract, fundamental breach. The injured party may use the remedy of avoidance by notifying the other party and returning any goods already received if they did not honor the contract. For example, if 30 days they did not pay, so you can always go to the remedies and see what are the rewards if you take up the remedies. I'll go through later some of the remedies. Request for specific performance. So injured party may be able to request specific performance if the other party is in breach. Okay, what is specific performance? Specific performance is a court order directing a party to carry out the obligation he or she had contractually promised to do. So you can bring the case to a court, then the court can give you a specific performance to be completed. That means carry out what you're supposed to do. That is a specific performance. That means what you're supposed to do in the original contract. Okay? The court also can decide the other way. A seller's obligation, a seller is required to deliver the goods, all this, basic responsibility of a seller, deliver the goods, hand over the document relating to them, invoice, whatever, receipts, ensure the goods are in good condition. So the faith comes in good faith. Don't sell something that is rotten. And there's one case to talk about it. The place of delivery also is normally agreed upon in the contract, whether you want to deliver in B in what location or A in what location. Okay? The place where the parties knew the goods were located and were to be manufactured. So all this has to be in the clauses of the contract. Time for delivery and turning over documents, all this also important, because a time and place of delivery, seller must turn over any document relating to the goods, for example, receipts, invoice and so on. Or credit letters involved if it is relevant. Conformity of goods. Goods do not conform unless they are fit for the purpose of which goods of the intent earlier they were come into agreement. Are fit for any particular purpose expressly or impliedly made known to the seller. So these are some of the things that the goods need to fulfill. Goods do not conform unless, that means the good must fulfill all these conditions. For example, D, are packaged in the same manner usual for a third party claims, waiver, time for examining goods and curing defects. I think you can read this, some of the concepts here. I will not go through this. Buyer's obligation, a buyer is required to pay the price, of course, and take delivery of the goods. The natural gas case. The plaintiff, a German company, negotiated to buy natural gas from Australian partnership. The defendant was to ship the propane from the US to the plaintiff in Belgium. The plaintiff was to obtain a letter of credit. Once the defendant told it where the propane was to be loaded. So the issue is, had the defendant breached the contract by failing to deliver the propane, or was it duty to perform excuse by the plaintiff not obtaining a letter of credit? Okay, they did not send the product by failing to deliver, that's one. Another one is not obtaining a letter of credit. They got two issues here. So the buyer was excused from opening a letter of credit because the defendant never provided the necessary information. Because earlier we said, whatever the person asks must give. But in this case, to prepare a letter of credit, the other person did not give enough information. So that's why the letter was not prepared, which is excused. The breach was due to the other one, non-delivery, seller's failure to make proper arrangement. Passage of risk, and this is very important, you know. What the photo shows, huh? Sinking ship in the Strait of Gibraltar. Strait of Gibraltar. Okay, let's look at this information here. Passage of risk is very important here. Who bear the cost of the damage while transportation? Whether a seller or a buyer. Very interesting, eh? Let's look at it. The legal concept of passage of risk. Passage of risk is the point of in time when the buyer becomes responsible for losses to the goods. Who? Buyer or seller? Buyer. Once the risk passes, the buyer must pay for the goods. Even they are damaged or destroyed. Let's say, you ordered roses, but due in the passage when they are transporting the products, you have to bear the cost. Let's say you order rose, but you only receive the stem, no rose. Okay? Of course, you can be protected by insurance. You can always protect yourself by buying insurance. So CSG allows the parties to allocate risk and specify when the risk will pass. So of course we also can buy the risk to mitigate. Buyer's remedies, these are remedies as I mentioned earlier, this is the one. The buyer remedies are cumulative, meaning they are able to be joined or taken together. The remedies unique to the buyer are to compare specific performance, to ask for specific performance by going to court and ask the other person to fulfill it, to avoid the contract, to reduce the price. So we can always, another remedy is avoid the contract, we don't want the contract anymore. Or ask for a reduced price. Earlier we said 20 ringgit, now we go for 10 ringgit because the other party have breached the contract. Okay, let's go for 10 ringgit. This is for the buyer to refuse early delivery and to refuse excess quantity. So these are some of the remedies the buyer can ask and demand for. The buyer may avoid a contract, the seller commits a fundamental breach, the buyer gives the seller a natch freeze notice. What is natch freeze? Let me go to that later. Number two, the buyer gives the seller a natch freeze notice and the seller rejects it or does not perform within the period of specified. What is natch freeze notice? A buyer's natch freeze notice, bullet number two, a buyer's natch freeze notice is the fixing of an additional period of time of reasonable length for performance by the seller or is her obligation. So this is giving, natch freeze means giving additional time. Additional time for the seller to complete the delivery or whatever. Maybe earlier we said 2 days, maybe you give, by giving the notice, Yeah, okay, never mind. I'll give you another additional one more day. So during the Nash freeze period, the seller is entitled to correct or cure the non-conformity. For example, he is supposed to send within 2 days, but the seller can't. By buyer sending the Nash freeze notice, he can cure or mitigate the mistake, the non-conformity at his or own expense. Okay? The buyer will not bear the cost. The shoe seller case. Plaintiff, an Italian business, contracted to sell shoes to the defendant, a German businesswoman. This is a shoe case. So we have gone through a few cases today. We talk about aircraft, we talk about gas, propane, we talk about shoe now. The shoes were delivered late and the defendant contended that they were non-conforming. Yes, whenever we did not fulfill the clause in the law, in the contract, the price, the duration of the delivery and so on, we did not conform to it. The shoes were delivered late. Of course, there is non-conformance. Defendant did not give a Nash freeze notice to say that, okay, you'll take longer time. No, this time there is no Nash freeze notice. Or attempt to use other remedies. There's nothing. So the court found no fundamental breach by the plaintiff. The plaintiff is Italian business. The shoes were delivered late and the defendant contended they were non-conforming. Defendant did not give a Nash freeze notice to attempt to use other remedies. So the court found no fundamental breach by the plaintiff. Okay? Reduction price can be another remedy. If a buyer is not entitled to damages when a seller delivers non-conforming goods, the buyer will be entitled to reduce the price. Earlier was 10 ringgit, now 5 ringgit because you send late. Okay, let's go for 5 ringgit. Okay, these are some of the formulas that they can use, but basically is one of the privilege by the buyer to reduce the price when there is a non-conformation. Remedies available to both buyers and sellers. Okay, this is for both. Just now we talk about seller remedy, we talk about buyer remedies. Now it's for the both. It's very straightforward for both because they can suspend the performance, avoidance anticipation of fundamental breach due to, for example, unforeseen issues, for example, like war. So they can cancel the whole contract. All right. So remedies available to both are, let me go through one by one. Suspension of the performance, that means over there, suspension, we don't have to do it. No conduct, no action based on the contract. The both agree, Avoidance in anticipation of fundamental breach, a remedy available to either party when it becomes clear that the other party will commit a fundamental breach. Avoidance of installment contract, no need to pay. Damages. So damages, a breaching party is liable only for those damages that he or she foresaw or ought to have foreseen. So let's say both, they can remedy. If they see something going to happen, the other one can come to agreement for a remedy where both agree. Excuses for non-performance, normally as I mentioned earlier, is due to disasters. Force majeure, a party is not liable for any damages when there is a disaster such as war or strike. Okay, plaintiff was to deliver 1,000 metric tons of chromite to the defendant in Sweden. The price of chromite rose 43% before delivery. Why? Because Sweden was in a big problem where they have the, that time there is a war and there is no beyond the control. Because the price goes up beyond the control, so they can beyond the control. Sorry, it's not war actually, it's beyond the control, the price. It's not war. So, since Sweden had not ratified the CSG, it is excuse for non-performance based on impediment beyond the party's control, where the price is beyond the control, the price went up. Okay, so held though the doctrine of commercial impracticability applied a 43% rise in was not sufficient to excuse the performance. So what's the held doctrine over here? A 43% rise in price was not sufficient to excuse. So look like it is the go ahead. Even though the price went up beyond the control, is what they are arguing. Look like they still have to pay for it. Maybe they argue in the sense of demand and supply, the price went up, where the buyer still have to bear the price hike. Done. Okay, good. We take a break for 5 minutes, then we can sit the review.